Hello students, welcome to the science class. Today I am here with you to discuss a chapter of grade 6. The name of the chapter is Things Around Us. That means in Hindi we can say Hamare Aaspaas Ki Cheezein. Okay, so in this chapter mainly we will be focusing on the living and non-living things around us. In our previous classes, we have already studied that the things around us can be grouped into two major categories, the living things and the non-living things. We have also studied that there is a huge diversity, immense diversity of living things on the earth. We also know that all the living things are natural, and the non-living things, they can be natural also and they can be man-made also. Okay, so for 6th grade, in this chapter, we shall discuss about. So we should say that the learning objectives of us are to learn the characteristics of living things, means what are the features which makes living things different from the non-living things. We'll also discuss about a new term called habitat. And along with the habitat, we will also discuss the components of habitat. So let's start with, first of all, some characteristics of living things. Before we start to talk about living things, before we start to talk about the characteristics, we should just understand which are the living things and which are the non-living things. If we look around, we find different plants, animals, human beings. They all around us are the living things. On the other hand, you see the clouds, the rocks, soil, your books, your pens, your table, your phone also. They all are the examples of non-living things. Now we'll put some light on the characteristics through which we can differentiate the living things from the non-living things. So amongst them, the very first and the very important differentiation is structural organization. We have studied that the living things, they are made up of tiny units of life, and those tiny units of life are called as cells. A cell is the smallest unit of the of organism which can function independently. All those functions which happens inside the body of an organism, they also take place inside the cell. When the different, when the similar kind of cells, they group together, they make a tissue. The different tissues then join together to form an organ to perform a specific function. Different organs then join to with each other to form an organ system. When different organ systems, they assemble, they form the body of the organism. So this is the structural hierarchy of the living organisms. Such kind of structural hierarchy is not shown by the non-living things. Okay, all the living things, whether they are plants or they are animals, they are having this type of structural organization. I want to add one more thing here, that according to the number of cells present in the body, the organisms can be of two types: unicellular organisms and multicellular organisms. The unicellular organisms are those which are in which the body is made up of only a single cell. All the functions of the body takes place inside that single cell. For example, amoeba, paramecium, euglena, bacteria, they all are the examples of unicellular organisms. On the other hand, the organisms which we see around generally, like human beings, plants, dogs, house fleas, mosquitoes, they all are multicellular. Means their body is made up of many cells. Multi means many, cellular means cells. So this was all about the structural organization. So here we go for the next important feature, that is respiration. First of all, we should understand the meaning of respiration. You see, when we breathe in, we take in oxygen gas. Oxygen gas is essential for us to survive. Why? Because it is the oxygen gas which is helpful to release the energy of the food which we eat. Okay, so respiration is the process in which we consume, we use the oxygen to release the energy of the food. We have different, we all are different types of living organisms. We all are not of same kind. So we cannot respire by same method. We all have different types of methods for respiration. First of all, we'll talk about the terrestrial animals. Terrestrial ka matlab, terrestrial meaning the land dwelling animals. The animals which survive on, which live on land. They all have lungs for respiration. Moving to the aquatic animals like fishes, you can see the pictures also. The chicken is shown with leg because it is a terrestrial animal. We also have lungs because we are terrestrial animals. Fishes, they live in water. They are aquatic, so they have gills in their body for respiration. You must have seen the earthworm in the rainy season. So earthworm uses their moist skin. Their skin is always moist, damp. So the moist skin helps to respire. The insects you can see here, the insects like caterpillar, they have small holes like structures on their body. These are called as spiracles, and these spiracles helps them for respiration. Moving on to the plants also, because they are also living, so they must be respiring. For that, they have small tiny pores, means holes on the lower surface of their leaves. The undersurface of the leaves are having very tiny pores, means holes, and those are called as the stomata. These stomata are helpful for the gaseous exchange in plants. So here we are. We have to do a comparative study to understand the further differences between the living and non-living things. Here we can comparatively study the characteristics which would be more beneficial for the learning outcomes. Okay, so first of all the living organisms, they cannot survive without food. We need food for our survival. The food gives us the energy which we use to do the daily activities and to grow also. On the other hand, the non-living things do not require any kind of food. We have studied that plants are autotrophs. They are producers. They can make their own food on their own by the process called as photosynthesis. And all the other animals, they take the food from plants directly or indirectly, and they also depend on other organisms. So the animals are called as the heterotrophs or the consumers. Moving on to the second point, we can say that the living things, they grow in size. We know the number of cells in a body of the organism, that increases, okay, and that leads to the growth in their size. If we drop a seed into a flower pot, it will sprout into a sapling for after some time, and that sapling will then convert into a fully grown tree after a couple of years. So that is the growth in size. Such kind of characteristic feature is shown by the living things and not the non-living things. Then plants and animals also show movements. We show different types of movements. If you don't move, then you won't be able to write, read, eat, speak, dance, walk. You cannot do all such things if you can't move. Okay, so all the plants and animals show different types of movements. You must be wondering how plants are showing movements. Yes, the answer comes in phototropism and geotropism. These are very important terms which needs to be understood by you. Phototropism is the phenomena of growth of the stem of a plant towards sunlight. The sunlight of plants, they always grow towards sunlight. That is called as the phototropism. And the roots of the plants, they always grow towards gravity. So that is called as the geotropism. So phototropism and geotropism are the examples of movements in plants. On the other hand, non-living things cannot move on their own. Okay. Then the living things, they show particular response towards stimulus in the environment. Whenever there is a certain change in the environment, the living things always respond. You must have studied about the reflex action. Yes, I'm talking about that only. Okay, so the living things, they always show responses towards the stimulus, but the non-living things never respond. If you take your hand towards a burning candle, you'll quickly retract your hand because you know you can respond. But if you put a wooden rod into the flame of the candle, a wooden stick into the flame of the candle, that will not come back on its own because it is a non-living thing. The plants like mimosa, if you touch the leaves of mimosa, they quickly close up and after some time they open up. So such kind of responses are shown by the plants and animals, and non-living things never show such kind of responses. Then next very important characteristic is living things do reproduction. See, if all the living things, they will die after some time, after a particular duration, then the life on earth will be finished. So living things are provided with a very unique feature called as reproduction. The living organisms, they reproduce with the help of different methods. Like the animals like birds, they lay eggs, so they are oviparous. On the other hand, the animals like buffalo or cat or dogs and human beings also, they give birth to a fully developed young one. So that type of organisms are called as viviparous animals. Okay, so on the basis of different types of reproduction, we have two types of organisms, oviparous and viviparous. The egg laying animals are called as the oviparous animals, while the animals giving birth to a young one are called as the viviparous animals. So reproduction cannot be done by the non-living things, we should understand. Then excretion, very important. The living things do excrete. First of all, you should understand what is the meaning of excretion. The process of removing waste out of the body is called as excretion. Okay, so the living organisms, either plants or animals, they both excrete the waste produced in their body. We remove the waste in the form of sweat, in the form of urine, and in the form of carbon dioxide. For these things, our skin, kidneys and lungs, they are the excretory organs. The plants also excrete their waste in the form of gum, resins, latex, rubber, or excess water vapor and oxygen also. So plants also do excrete the waste. If the living organisms do not excrete the waste, they may fall ill because these wastes are poisonous. Okay. Non-living things are not showing any kind of life activities, so there is no waste and there is no excretion also. Coming to the last point, the living things have a particular lifespan. We all know that all the living organisms, they take birth, they grow, they become a child, and then they grow into adults, and then they become old and finally die. So This is the complete cycle. This complete cycle of an organism from its birth to death is called as the life cycle. And the duration is called as the lifespan. In this universe, all the living organisms have a particular lifespan. Different organisms have different lifespans during their life cycle. No such kind of life cycle is shown by the non-living things. I hope this comparison is understood by you. Coming to the next very unique topic called habitat. Now we should understand. Everybody knows their address, right? But it's not about address. The habitat is the natural home of an organism. Natural home, what is the meaning of natural home? Means by nature, where can we survive? If we talk about us, the human beings, can we survive in water? No, definitely no, because we are made to survive only on land. Similarly, if you talk about fish, the fish cannot survive on land. It is made to survive in the water. So, the natural home is that which is decided by the nature. We can say that The natural home of an organism is called as its habitat. All the organisms, they get all their needs fulfilled in that habitat only. On our earth, we have different types of habitats. For example, terrestrial habitat, aquatic habitat, aerial means in air, like birds. Arboreal habitats means the trees, the animals living on trees. Okay. Now, habitat is having two main components. The habitat is always made up of two types of components. This is almost similar to the living and non-living, but we shall discuss them separately. First of all, we'll talk about the biotic components. The living components of the habitat are called as the biotic components. We have already studied which things are living things. Plants, animals, scavengers, decomposers, they all are the living components. That's why they are called as the biotic components of the habitat. All these components have a very close relationship amongst themselves. Okay, if we talk about plants, they make their own food by photosynthesis, so they are producers, or autotrophs also we can say to them. Animals take food from plants or other animals, so they are consumers, or the heterotrophs. Yes, scavengers and decomposers, very important category. They play very important role in the decomposition of all the dead matter. Okay, they return the nutrients of the soil back and also keep our earth neat and clean. If they don't do so, if scavengers are decomposers are absent on the earth will be filled with garbage. Okay, now let's talk about the abiotic components, very important also. All the non-living things around you, like soil, sunlight, air, water, and temperature, are called as the abiotic components of the habitat. Now, you must be wondering that non-living things are these furnitures and like anything which we studied in the non-living category, are they abiotic components? So the answer is no. The abiotic components are the components of a habitat. We are not talking about your house. We are talking about the natural home of an organism. Okay. So in the natural home of an organism, the non-living components are soil, sunlight, air, water, and temperature. Okay. We shall discuss them one by one. All these components are dependent upon each other, as well as they interact with the living components, means biotic components also, to maintain the habitat. We will discuss it in detail. First of all, we will talk about the soil. What is soil? Soil is the topmost layer of earth. Okay, it is formed by the withering of rocks. Withering means breaking. What it provides? It provides the water, minerals, and air to the growing plants. If the soil is absent, the plants cannot grow. And everybody knows, if the plants will not grow, they will not make food, and we won't get food. The life on earth will be finished. Second important thing is sunlight. Sunlight is the ultimate source of energy for all. Why? Because plants, they get sunlight to perform photosynthesis and they make food. The other organisms, they directly or indirectly depend on the plants only. So if sunlight is not there, the plants will not make food and nobody will get food. Moving on to the air. Air provides oxygen and carbon dioxide, very important gases. You see, we need carbon dioxide for plants to make food, and we need oxygen for us for breathing. Okay, so both of these gases are very important, and we get them from the air only. So if air is absent, we won't stay alive. Next thing is water. Everybody knows about the vitality of the water. Water is very vital for the survival of living things. Okay, it is life-giving. Plants use water for photosynthesis. We use water as solvent in our body, and all the body processes like digestion also, they cannot take place in the absence of water. Okay, aquatic animals, they absorb the oxygen dissolved in water only. So water is very, very essential. The next is temperature. Temperature is very important to understand. Temperature is the measure of heat of an object. By the temperature, we can say whether the object is hot or cold. When we say that temperature is high, means it is hot. When we say that temperature is low, it's cold. Okay, so the temperature is a very important abiotic component. We all know that the earth is spherical and all parts of earth do not receive equal heat of the sun. So therefore, some places near the polar regions are very, very cold and the regions near to equator are very, very hot. That's why in these particular habitats, the temperature affects the population of plants and animals. Now you need to understand the animals such as mammals and birds who maintain a relatively constant body temperature like us. The body temperature of us remains constant almost every time. It is maintained at 37 degrees Celsius. So such kind of animals in which the body temperature remains same, such kind of animals are called as the warm-blooded animals. Okay. On the other hand, the animals like reptiles, fishes, they can change their body temperature to match the outside temperature. Such kind of animals are called as the cold-blooded animals. Because we are warm-blooded animals, this is the reason we have to get warm clothes in the winter and we have to get cotton clothes in the summers, because we cannot adjust our body temperature with the environment. Okay, so that was the difference between the cold-blooded and warm-blooded animals. Okay, warm-blooded animals maintain body heat by burning food they eat, whereas the cold-blooded animals gain most of their body heat from the sun only. Okay, so that was all about the chapter. I hope you guys got a great help from this explanation. Okay, so sign